And tonight we have a two-for-one special. We have with us Drs. Alex Rosati and Felix Warneken, who are going to talk to us about their current research on chimpanzees and evolutionary cooking. And they are both located at Harvard University in Oxford. So please welcome Dr. Alexandra Rosati and Dr. Felix Warneken.
But before we talk about the research on the evolution of cooking, I thought we should talk a little bit about the evolution of the research for us, which for us started when we both were reading this really inspiring book, Catching Fire, which was written by the anthropologist at Harvard, Bridget Ram, here on the right in front, who tackled the problem in this book that we humans have relatively large brains when we compare ourselves to other animals, including chimpanzees. And that creates a problem because brain tissue is energetically very costly. So we really need a lot of energy to grow and sustain these large brains. And so the question is, where does this energy come from? What is also a fact is that our guts are relatively small when we look at other animals. So even though we don't think with our guts, most of the time, we need our guts to think because the guts provide the energy to grow and sustain these large brains. So what is the solution to this problem to be able to evolve these large brains and find the right energy for that? And the provocative claim by Richard Wrangham in this book is that cooking can do the job. And the reason is that when we cook food, we're able to extract more energy from it. Basically, we make it softer, we break it down more, we kind of pre-process it, and then when we eat it, we are able to extract more energy from it. So what this leads to over evolutionary time is that we can grow bigger brains, and our guts become smaller because they don't have to do all the work. So this is the hypothesis by Richard Wrangham. But for this hypothesis to really work, to really explain what makes us human, as the subtitle here suggests, cooking must have evolved very early in our human ancestry.
So this raises the really important question of how do you test this hypothesis? So what evidence from science can we use to see whether cooking evolved early in human evolution? So previous research has suggested two main ways of testing this hypothesis. So the one that immediately leaps to mind is to look for evidence of the control of fire. So archaeologists, for example, will go look for evidence of actual hearths or rocks that have been burned and have evidence of cooking on them. And this is really strong evidence that these creatures in the past were using fire and also using it to cook food. But unfortunately, this kind of evidence is fairly fragile. So Richard Wrangham's hypothesis suggests that cooking emerged as early as 2 million years ago. And these kinds of evidence from hearths don't necessarily last that long in order to find them. So, you know, these early hominins might have been using fire, but we might not be able to find it in the archaeological record. So another way people have tested this is by looking at morphology. So you can look at the fossil skeletons of creatures that lived in the past and try to see if there's evidence that they shifted their diet to this softer, cooked food kind of diet. And so the idea is that you might look for changes in the teeth because you don't need as robust teeth to chew these softer cooked foods. You might look for changes in the torso because, as Felix mentioned, the gut might have gotten smaller. And so this is also really interesting evidence that can go farther back in time. But one problem is that these kinds of shifts in morphology might not actually be reflective of a shift to cooking specifically. So they might show that these creatures ate a different kind of diet, but they could have just been eating some other kind of soft food, for example. So this is where we had our insight that actually there's a third way to test this hypothesis. And this third line of evidence is actually psychology. So by studying the cognition and behavior of living apes. And the reason is that actually studying living apes can actually help us try to understand what this last common ancestor how this last common ancestor behaved and thought. So we don't know what this creature was like, this last common ancestor of apes and humans, but we can make a lot of inferences about how it behaved by looking at the living apes, because those are our best model for what this creature was like. So if we can see that living apes have a set of psychological or behavioral skills, this suggests that this last common ancestor also might have possessed those skills. And coincidentally, this is actually exactly what Felix and I do. So we thought, what a striking coincidence. And actually, we conduct behavioral study with chimpanzees at a place called Chimpunga Chimpanzee Sanctuary, which is located in the Republic of Congo. It's actually the largest chimpanzee sanctuary in Africa. It cares for over 160 chimpanzees that free range on over 90 acres of forest. So this is a sanctuary managed by the Jane Goodall Institute that's caring for orphans of the bushmeat and pet trade. So the idea is that the Jane Goodall Institute, in collaboration with the Congolese government, will actually help to confiscate infant apes that have been captured by poachers. So when these apes come into the sanctuary, they're often very young. In the wild, they would still be dependent on their mother. So they're actually given a surrogate human parent who will carry them around, feed them food, sleep with them, much like a real chimpanzee mother would. But importantly, these chimpanzees also will have a lot of contact with other chimpanzees, so they don't just live with humans, but they're very rapidly introduced to other chimpanzees in nursery groups like this group you see on the right. And the idea is that this sort of human parenting can give these chimpanzees the skills to live in a very naturalistic environment like this. So once the chimpanzees are older, they spend most of their day in these 90 acres of primary tropical rainforest, where they free range with other chimpanzees and live a very naturalistic life. So what this gives us the opportunity to do is to test chimpanzees who are living in this very natural environment, but are also very familiar with humans, because there would be problems with trying to conduct these kinds of psychology studies with wild apes, where you wouldn't normally want to interfere with their day-to-day life. But because these chimpanzees are familiar with humans, and they actually come into dormitories at night to sleep, we can basically set up little psychology games to play with them. It's very similar to what a developmental psychologist might do to test a child to understand how children think about the world. So basically, the apes will play little games where they get treats like a banana or something like that when we bring them into these dormitories.
So our goal was then to develop an experiment that will allow us to test to what extent chimpanzees have the abilities to cook their food. And so when we were thinking about what tests should we use, obviously the first question was, what are the cognitive abilities that you have to cook food? And the first thing is that you have to be motivated to obtain cooked food, so you have to have some preference for food to be cooked over raw, okay? So this was the first goal. So we wanted to test whether chimpanzees prefer cooked food over raw food. And we picked white sweet potato. This is something that they get at the sanctuary on a regular basis, but usually not cooked, right? And so what we did is we first tested whether they prefer these raw sweet potatoes, these sweet potatoes raw or cooked. And on a practical side, what this meant that every morning we spent several hours preparing many, many slices of potato and fried them. We didn't add any salt, no butter, anything. So it's really the same thing, just heated up. And with that, we could then run our studies. So the first experiment we did was we wanted to see, do they prefer this raw version or the cooked version? And so what we did is, you will see how I place a raw slice of potato on one side of the table and a cooked slice on the other side of the table, push it forward, and then the chimpanzee can choose what he or she wants to eat.
Cuckoo.
This first study was that after tasting it a little bit, they would reliably choose the cooked one over the raw one. So they really had a strong preference to eat things cooked rather than raw.
So that was exciting, but that's a very basic skill that you would need to cook. Obviously, there's a lot of other things you need to do as well. And one thing we thought that would be especially important is to have patience. Because, of course, to get cooked food, you don't just get cooked food immediately. You have to actually wait. It's a temporal process. And this is a critical capacity because, of course, cooking creates this conflict between taking the raw food you already have and eating it now versus waiting for this better benefit to come in the future. And I think anybody who's ever baked a cookie knows exactly what this conflict feels like, because there's this immediate temptation of eating the raw cookie dough, but you know you should wait for those better cookies that are going to come out of the oven in a few minutes. So we wanted to present the chimpanzees with a test of whether they could wait for these cooked food rewards. And the way we did it was that we gave them a choice between a smaller amount of food that they could have now, or they could wait for a large amount of food. So in this particular version of the study, what you're going to see is that the chimpanzee sees one piece of raw food placed on the left, and then three pieces of raw food placed on the right. And the chimpanzee already knows that she's going to have to wait 1 minute if she chooses those three pieces. So she's already experienced that. So here she's faced with this choice. Does she give in to immediate temptation, or should she wait it out?
Cool.
So in this case, you can see that the chimpanzee, she'd rather go with the immediate temptation. And the trick is that then in a second condition, what we did was we made that larger delayed reward actually cooked. So would the chimpanzees be more willing to wait if the food was actually cooked? Chimpanzees don't really like to wait, so she took a little bit of, she hesitated there, and after a minute, then she gets that food. So I didn't make you wait through the whole minute, but it actually feels like a fairly long time for a chimpanzee staring at the three pieces of food that she's waiting for. And so actually the results we found were fairly similar to these videos. So we found that they were generally willing to wait for the delayed rewards, but if those rewards were cooked, they were even more willing to wait. So it seemed like chimpanzees expressed this extra patience in the context of cooked foods.
So, okay, they like their food cooked and they can wait for it, but then we're wondering, what if we give them raw food and the opportunity to cook? Will they be able to turn that into cooked food, which presents a strong self-control, right? Because in principle, this already tastes pretty good, but will I give it up for it to be cooked? So the most straightforward way of testing this would obviously be to give them some kind of cooking device. And as a matter of fact, we brought a camping cooker type of thing to the sanctuary, but very quickly realized that there's just no way to run this experiment safely. Imagine a chimpanzee getting a hold of a gas tank. So what we did instead is we developed a different form of cooking that I want to illustrate here. So the chimpanzee saw that when you put a raw slice of potato into a bowl and close it with a lid, and then shake it for 5 seconds and open it, it comes out cooked, right? How did we do that? We used a false bottom so it made it appear as if this was this transformation. And then we contrasted this cooking device with a control device where the raw thing goes in, we move it around for 5 seconds, we open it, but it stays raw. So we call that the raw shaker. So what we did in the first study was we exposed them to these two different devices and tested that they would like to be fed from the cooking device over the control device, giving some initial evidence that they understood that. But the critical test was then, what would they do when we give them a raw slice of potato? So what we did is we held out the cooking device and the raw shaker and then placed a piece of raw food in the middle and then looked what they would do. And they could eat it, they could place it in the cooking device, they could put it in the shaker, or they could just ignore it. So here's one example.
Yoko. Yoko.
So what we found was that actually several of the chimpanzees would have the ability to give up the food and place it reliably in this cooking device and get it back cooked.
So to be frank, that kind of blew my mind. I actually didn't think this study would work. Felix said, let's go for it. I said, okay, it's our last day here. It was the last day of our trip. We ran this study. It kind of was shocking to us that it worked. And unfortunately, we were about to leave, so we had to wait a whole year to do a bunch of other tests because we were so intrigued by the fact that they were able to give up this food. Because actually, a lot of previous research has shown that chimpanzees and other primates, you know, if they've got the food in the hand, they don't want to give it up. But these chimpanzees seem to make this spontaneous inference that they could place their food in this device and transform it in some way. So when we came back a year later, we were actually really interested in what did they really think was happening. Because you might imagine that another really important aspect of cooking is actually this understanding of the causal transformation that happens, that you have raw food and you transform it into cooked food. But one alternative is that these chimpanzees just thought they could place any old thing in these bowls and then something delicious would pop out. And so we wanted to really nail whether they understood what was happening. So you can imagine the case that, like, when you put food in the microwave, you understand that it's being warmed up and cooked. But you don't think if you put a brick in the microwave that you would get a delicious dinner out of it. So maybe the chimpanzee thought they could put a brick in the microwave and get food out of there. So the first way we tried to test that was actually by changing up the kinds of foods we gave chimpanzees that they could place in the device. So it was the same setup as the videos Felix just showed, but we gave them different types of food to see how they generalized their knowledge of these devices to new situations. So first we checked that these chimpanzees a year later did like to cook their raw potato, and we found that they did. The next thing we did was we gave them raw carrot. So they'd never seen raw carrot ever associated with these devices. I bet most of the chimpanzees had never seen raw carrot at all. And actually, a significant portion of them chose to place their raw carrot in this device despite never having seen it placed in there before. But then the final trick was that we gave the chimpanzees pre-cooked potato. The idea here is that if the food is already cooked, you don't need to place it in the device because it's already cooked. Nothing is going to change. If the chimpanzees really understood that what was happening was a transformation of raw food into cooked food, they should just eat this pre-cooked potato and not try to place it in any of the devices. And actually, that's what we found. So when we gave the chimpanzees pre-cooked potato, they just ate it directly. They didn't try to place it in these devices. So that was pretty exciting for us. And the other way we wanted to test this issue of whether they understood the causal transformation of cooking was to see whether they thought they could place other things in the device and get cooked food out. And so in particular, what we did was we gave them raw potato, just like the previous studies, but we also gave them a wood chip. So the wood chip looked a lot like a raw potato, but it's inedible. So if chimpanzees think they can just place any old thing in this device and they can get back a delicious meal, they might try to place both of these things in the device, or maybe even they'd prefer to eat the raw potato and try to stick this wood chip in the device to try to double their rewards. So in the next video, I'll show you what this looked like. So what you're gonna see here is that that Felix is holding out the device, and a staff member is going to place a wood chip and a piece of raw potato on both sides of the bowl. So chimpanzee has access to both of them at the same time. And our question was, which one would the chimpanzee choose to place in the device? In placing this inedible item in the device, and in fact, they didn't seem to really see what the connection was at all between that wood chip and the devices.
So, the next question we asked ourselves was that usually you can't just obtain food and immediately cook it, right? So you have to do something that you could call future planning. So you have to do something that enables you to cook food at some later opportunity. And I mean, obviously, for us as modern humans, that is the case, that we go to a grocery store and collect our food there, buy our food, and then bring it home to cook it there. But this is also true for more traditional societies where people would collect or hunt food in one place and then bring it back to camp where it's then processed and eaten. So we were wondering to what extent chimpanzees are able to do that, because what they usually do out in the wild is that their cooking station. But this was back here with the cooking device and the shaker. But now they receive the food around like the distances maybe from here to over there at this other location from a caregiver. what we saw was that the chimpanzees were really able to do that. And this, again, requires even more self-control because, as you saw here, this chimpanzee was carrying the slice in his mouth, right? So this is something where sometimes they, whoops, had eaten it, or one chimpanzee would grab it and run over as fast as possible, holding the food as far away from him as he could. So they were successful at this, not quite as successful as when they could do it immediately, showing us that it is a challenge, but they master it. But the next thing is, however, about this future component. So they master space. Will they master time? So what we did was we had, again, a situation where they received food on one end, but I was not there at that moment. I would appear 3 minutes later with the cooking device, right? And then if they still had food left, they would be able to place it in the cooker. And so we did that 10 times in a row so that they could learn that I couldn't tell them, hey, I'll be back, right? And so, but they could learn over time that even though when they receive food, the cooker isn't there, but the cooker will appear later in 3 minutes. So what you will see here in this video is first how the chimpanzee receives the food, and then later in the clip you will see how I appear with the cooking device. Save the food in this condition, but this was contrasted with a control condition in which they also received food at this time interval, but the cooker was never around, right? So in this situation, there's no point in saving the food, and as a matter of fact, the chimpanzees would eat it right away. So this tells us that they were not holding on to the food randomly, but they would do it selectively when they had the opportunity to cook it in the future. So what we noticed at some later point was that leaving chimpanzees all by themselves can have its own risks. So we want to show you this video from the control condition where for like basically a half an hour we were never around.
They preferred the cooked food over raw food. They were willing to wait for delayed cooked foods rather than giving into this immediate temptation. They showed self-control. They could inhibit their responses to eat these raw foods in order to place it in this novel cooking device they had never seen before. And when they did so, they seemed to understand something about what they were doing. They weren't just, you know, putting anything in the device. They really understood that placing specifically raw food in the device was beneficial to them. And these last set of studies suggest that they even can somehow anticipate future opportunities to cook and plan at least for a few minutes to place their raw food in those devices. So I think together, given that chimpanzees have these skills, it suggests that early hominins also may have had many of these skills. So these skills probably predated the control of fire. And I think this suggests that as soon as fire was adopted, early hominins were able to use it to cook their food, supporting the cooking hypothesis that cooking emerged relatively early in human evolution. So chimpanzees probably won't be showing up on MasterChef anytime soon. But they probably are thinking about it. So we also just want to thank all of the people that helped us with these studies, so especially the animal caretakers that you saw in several of the videos. I'd like to point out Jean-Aimé Chikaya and Angel Macasso, and then also the Jane Goodall Institute that has supported us in our research at the sanctuary.
Thank you. Leave it on.
We have time for some questions, and I'll pass around this microphone, so just wait till I get to you. And
very good.
Did you consider leaving the cooking device with them? Did you try that? See if they would try to cook on their own?
That's a great question. I think we never did that because, you know, we were worried about the chimpanzees breaking it. but actually, we noticed that when we would walk around, we would carry these bowls around often because we would be going to different buildings, and some chimpanzees would run up with raw food they just happened to find in their room. So it seemed like they really got it. My guess is that they might have tried to do it, but of course it wouldn't have worked because we wouldn't have been there to put the cooked food in the false bottom. But I think if we were able to come up with a device that they could manipulate on their own, and that was safe, my guess is that they probably could do it.
So I have a bunch of questions. You can answer one or any or whatever. One question is, why did you use the local Harvard chimpanzees from the side building? The second question is, the chimpanzees that chose not to cook the food, is that, I know you don't have an fMRI machine in Africa, but any suspicions that they have a smaller brain?
Yeah, I think we don't really know what the chimpanzees that chose not to cook. I'm not sure we know why. My guess is that there were some of these cognitive skills that we looked at. Those chimpanzees weren't quite up to snuff. So, for example, some of the chimpanzees might have had a real serious problem with overcoming this temptation to eat the food in their hand. So one thing we observed is that there would be some chimpanzees who would just always eat it, and they never seemed to get past that. Whereas other chimpanzees would, you know, once they had the insight that they could play, you'd see them have this insight, like the light bulb would go off in their head. And then after that, they would cook it at fairly high rates. And I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch your first question.
Why did you use
local chimpanzees? Yeah, actually, there are no chimpanzees at Harvard. So this is really the only opportunity for us to conduct these studies. And the other thing, as Alex mentioned, what is really unique about this is that we have this huge population. I mean, we didn't even talk about the sample sizes here, but we were able to test almost like 50 chimpanzees here. And usually when you run studies in at research institutions in the US, you have to have a much smaller sample. So this is another reason that we have the opportunity to work with the Jane Goodall Institute to study a much larger population. Sorry.
Did the chimpanzees who were not cooking the food originally, was they able to learn from the other chimpanzees who were cooking it from the beginning?
So we did not look into this. So we just exposed them to these apparatuses. Chimpanzees are usually not very good at learning socially from others, and so this may have even been a constraint on human ancestors passing on this kind of knowledge. So what we were really looking at here are individual skills, right? But it takes a lot of people to really develop it as a technology. So this might be another reason why in human evolution it maybe took some time to really become a regular practice.
It was a wonderful presentation, thank you. You showed that they have all the cognitive skills that you need for cooking, but you could also say, like, the same skills you also need for play, like, for a team sport or any kind of play. So how do you see that these skills are related to cooking and related to other things like things that you can play?
Right.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So of course, we don't think that these skills evolve for cooking because we know that chimpanzees can't cook. So our idea is that these are sort of domain general skills that are constraining the ability to cook. So if you don't understand these different components of cooking, you couldn't engage in it. Of course, it could be very well that humans have additional skills that we now have evolved that allow us to cook in even more sophisticated ways. But I think these skills are probably very useful in foraging contexts. So for example, when animals are foraging in the wild, they have to make the decision decision whether to eat, you know, maybe from a lower quality patch that's right here or traveling some distance and some time to a higher quality patch somewhere else. They might need to inhibit eating food that has a big husk on it, for example, in order to process the food. So these are skills that probably animals, like chimpanzees especially, are using to process their food in the wild, but they can apply it to this novel problem that, that emulates cooking as well. Does that answer your question? I can do it.
Yeah.
There has been some work suggesting that really the key thing about cooking is that it allows you to extract more energy from foods. So there's, for example, been studies placing rodents on artificial diets where they're eating more raw food or cooked food, and you can actually see that the rodents maintain higher weight when they're on this cooked food diet of the exact same kind of food, suggesting that even animals that aren't, you know, specifically evolved to eat cooked food actually can extract more energy out of it. I think in this case, the chimpanzees in the sanctuary, you know, most of the food they're getting are not from our studies. They're just getting a couple of potatoes each day, so we didn't really notice anything. I think you'd probably have to do a much more controlled study where you, you know, looked at all the other components of their diet, of which we, you know, they were just free feeding the rest of the day. Yes?
Did you try other things?
Oh, sorry, I think there's...
Beyond the carrots and potatoes, did you try another variety of food? Was the reward different depending on the given
choice? Should I do it?
Oh,
yeah.
So yeah, that's a really interesting question. I mean, what we wanted to do is just find one type of food, one comparison where they like raw, but they like cooked better, as we established in our first experiment, and then go with that so that so that it's consistent. But it's a really interesting question to what extent this is true for all kinds of foods. There's also a study by our colleague Tori Wobber where she showed that, for example, when it's fruit or something, then there's not much of an improvement through cooking. So that would be something where the prediction is that they wouldn't actually cook that because it does not doesn't provide this additional tastiness and softness. So this would really be something we want to do in the future.
There is normally this assumption that animals are quite afraid of fire, but actually with chimpanzees in particular, there are some observations in the wild of chimpanzees just sort of calmly monitoring bushfires from a distance. I'm sure if the fire got very close to them, they would be scared. I know at the sanctuary, we're working in a place where there are bushfires, and when the fires approach very closely, the chimpanzees are scared. But if they can maintain a safe distance, they tend to just watch it and look at what direction it's going. There's even some observations that are quite intriguing of chimpanzees entering forests where bushfires have passed through and actually, eating the nuts that have been burned from the fire. I think suggesting that they, they may not really understand what's happening, but they learn some sort of association there that there's something tasty in there. And I think that's really interesting given our results, suggesting that probably they're actually doing something fairly cognitively complex when they're showing those kinds of behaviors in the wild. Yes?
Here. Yes, I just wanted to ask. Do other animals have preferences for cooked foods? If you were able to train like there was a smart dog or a pig or something like that, where you could get to a similar level, would that be problematic for what you're arguing? Or is it, would those things not care well?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And my guess is that a lot of mammals would show the same preferences for cooked food that we showed here. So you could imagine, you know, like your pet dog probably likes cooked food. But also the reasons that humans like cooked food are due to fairly conserved aspects of the taste apparatus. So cooked food tastes better. And the reasons it does are going to be the same for other mammals as well. So for example, cooking increases the sugar content of foods. So probably these are things a lot of animals would respond to. And in fact, we know all great apes prefer cooked food, and there's evidence from, you know, rodents, other mammals, that they also prefer cooked food. My guess is where the problem would be is that we'd be more difficult to show that other animals necessarily have all these other skills. So in things like patience and self-control and planning, there's, you know, maybe some scattered evidence of other animals having these abilities, but most of the time apes are really outperforming, you know, even other primates like monkeys. So my guess is that, you know, you might see that some of these components are shared to some extent with other species, but that apes are showing them really robustly across the board. Does that answer your question?
Okay, add something?
Oh. And the thing is also, yeah, so it's really something that this is not just one behavior, it's like a complex of skills that you have to have. And one important thing is that we're not arguing that chimpanzees can actually cook, right? So we checked off a list, but we don't know how long that list actually is. So you can come up with other things that are necessary. So one thing, for example, is that cooking usually occurs in a social context. And so what we looked at here are purely the individual skills. And so what we also know from chimpanzees is that they're very competitive over food. And so the cooking is very risky, because if you have something raw, you eat it, you have it, that's it. If, however, you transport it somewhere and cook it and someone watches you, then they might steal it. So, and this actually is also something that Richard Wrangham argues in his book, that the ability to cook itself is maybe not sufficient. It has to kind of go hand in hand with more social tolerance and more cooperativeness and maybe even some kind of sense of ownership, that this is, you collected this, and now you can cook it and keep it, and not the more dominant is just taking everything away. So this is why the test of what is needed to cook food has not ended here with our experiments.
Oh, hi. So these tests, are you able to definitively prove that it was actually taste that they preferred, and not something like smell or texture or color or, you know, just something else like that? Were you able to really drill down and prove that it was taste and nothing else?
Oh, I see. Yeah, so it's true. I mean, we're agnostic about what aspect of it really is. So, but I mean, that is not, it's not a problem for our study, right? So this is just that whatever the heating of these potatoes does to it, that is what makes it preferable to them. And then, but there are other studies with other animals, also from Richard Engel group in particular, that really try to pin down what exactly is it that makes the cooked food more preferable. And one thing, as Alex mentioned, is that it's softer. So even if you don't heat something but make it softer, usually would prefer that. So this is one important aspect of that. Yeah.
Right. I guess that one thing I was thinking about is that is most of what we taste, what we enjoy, is the most of the smell. So a lot of times when animals might look at cooked food, they might be really thinking about the smell of the food, because a lot of times because heating up kind of brings out the smell or something.
I see. So I mean, one important thing is that we they were cold, like the potatoes are, so that is, they're not very different in that regard. But I think, I mean, the smell is a good indicator of taste, right? This is strongly correlated. So I'm not sure that we can really tease that apart, but more that this is a proxy for what it will be like to actually eat it. Yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one thing, which is that, as an aside, we actually tasted these potatoes. So we didn't just feed them the chips, we actually tried them ourselves. And it was actually striking how much they preferred the cooked foods, given that, you know, to us they didn't taste that much better. I mean, they weren't cooked for very long. They were just cooked for about a minute on in the pan with no additives or anything, because the idea was that we wanted to emulate the delays we used in the later studies. So it wasn't like this was, you know, a boiled potato versus a raw potato. This was a, you know, a minimally cooked slice of potato compared to this raw potato. They didn't even look that different, to be honest.
Thank you so much for the presentation. One of the questions I have is, since you talk so much about the potential energy benefits that chimpanzees are, you know,
primates or herb would get from actually having the food already be cooked? Were you able to at all study what would happen as a result of them having the cooked food? For instance, like during the day, they had more energy to play every other things or whatever, such that then developmentally this would, you know, this would be something which would have benefit overall, not just in terms of they like food.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. I think, unfortunately, our study wasn't really designed to let us test that. Other people have looked at putting like rodents on experimental diets where they're really controlling what they're eating, and you know, you can see that actually, you know, they might be more energetic or something when they're on the diet. But that with the apes, I mean, these were sort of 20-minute studies where they got some potatoes, but most of the food the chimps ate were either provisioned by the caretakers at other times in the day, or also they engaged in a lot of foraging in the forest. So it's actually very hard for us to see what they were doing the rest of the day. To be honest, this is one reason we probably would have a difficult time testing that in this environment. But I think in other situations, that would be a great question. So and I don't really know the answer.
Thank you again, Professors Rosati and Warneken.
The reason to plant trees in the city is because of mitigating the urban heat island effect and reducing what the energy consumption in cities would be. If you want to keep canopy cover in cities, what I think, and I've thought about this for a little while, what I think we really need to do is we need to keep planting, but more importantly, we need to keep those big trees alive.